morning. Happy Sunday and welcome to Heartland Church. We're so happy that all of you are joining us online today. We'd love to take this opportunity to learn a little bit more about you. So in the comments or the chat, put in where you're watching us from. Also, today is the start of Holy Week, Palm Sunday, and Pastor Darren has an amazing message for you. We just got out of 9 o'clock service. So if we haven't had a chance to meet, I'm Rebecca Borman, and this is my best friend, Amber Fields.
Hey.
We're part of the Dream Team Communications team. I've been coming to Heartland for just about 12 years now, and Amber?
We've been here almost 2 years. Rebecca faithfully was an invitation for us to join this church for 7 straight years. And it is in God's time, not our time, right?
That's
and
right.
We walked into this church for the very first time, felt like home, and never left.
Yes, I love it. It makes me so happy. We both have family and friends watching online today. So, hey, you all, especially our family up in Fort Wayne. One of our favorite things about Heartland Church is the small groups. We've had an opportunity to do quite a few together now.
Yes.
And we're currently leading a small group called Be the Bridge with Amber's husband and our friend, Dr. Verone Contrell.
Yes.
So if you haven't hopped into a small group yet, please check those out. There's so many options, dozens and dozens of them. And there's online and in-person options. So
That's a peek. That's right. And today we are doing communion together. So take the elements, get them ready. At the end of the service, Pastor Darren will do communion together. It's a wonderful celebration of the life of Jesus Christ. And speaking of that, Easter is just a week away, April 7th through the 9th, and we have an incredible opportunity to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus all together. So we have services starting on Friday night at 6 p.m., Saturday at 4 p.m., and Sunday at 9 a.m., 10:30 a.m., and 12 p.m. So if you've never come to Heartland in person, join us. What a wonderful weekend to come hang out with us, celebrate the resurrection. And if you have been joining us, invite a friend.
Yep.
Bring out your friends and your family. It's going to be an incredible experience. And we just don't want you to miss out on that. And if you can't make it because you don't live around here, that's okay too. We will be doing all services online for next weekend as well.
That's right. And if you're watching us today on Facebook or YouTube, one way that you can continue to connect with us is to like and subscribe. That way you'll get all the information and won't miss a beat with us.
That's right. So it is almost that time, Rebecca, and they worship every single week. I'm telling you,
yes.
Goosebumps. It's so amazing. We are so excited that you are here. Thank you again for joining us. We're going to head inside to an amazing message about rejoicing, even in the time of persecution.
Right.
So again, enjoy the worship, and we will see you hopefully sometime really soon.
Enjoy, y'all.
Deliver us from place in the presence of God, there is fullness of joy. And at his right hand, there was pleasures for forevermore. The songs it says, I searched the world. It's gone. But it couldn't fill me. And man's empty praise and treasure that fades, I'll never enough. Let's go. Then you came along. Let's go. And you put me back together. Yeah. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Come on, lift your voice. Come on, say it. Come on, say it.
Better than you, Lord.
Better than you. Oh, there's nothing.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Nothing is better than our God. Hallelujah. The song says that he makes beauty out of ashes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He'll turn shame into glory. How many of you have had some shameful situations that God has brought you out of? Hallelujah. I know I have. That song testifies of God's great ability to change anything. Hallelujah. So as we continue in worship today, I want you to get that impossible situation, that thing that feels like it won't change. I know we all have one. Now I want you to offer it up to God in your worship, because God is the only man that can change it. He can change any situation. He's a good God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. It's from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yes.
I love your voice.
You have led me through the fire. It's in darkest nights that you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Yes, in all my life you have been faithful. Oh, yes, he has. In all my
this morning.
Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And we're so thankful that your goodness is running after, it's running after.
Come on, say
your goodness is running after. Your goodness is running after. Your goodness is running after. So God, with our lives laid down, say, with my life laid down, surrender now, I give you everything. 'Cause your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Father, we are so thankful for your goodness. We're so thankful for your kindness. So thankful for your patience, Lord Jesus. We know, God, if it had not been for you in our lives, we would be lost. So we give you glory this morning. We ask that you would have your way in this service. We open our hearts and we hold nothing back. Do a new thing in each one of us this morning. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. It's such a blessing to see so many wonderful faces this morning. And if we can, let's take a moment and celebrate everybody who is here for the first time and those who are joining us online. We are so grateful that you chose to be with us this morning. We're going to get right into Heartland News and into the rest of our service. But before that, find a couple people, give them a high five, tell them it is good to see you this morning.
My name is JC, and I'm so glad you're with us today. Before we get into the message, there are a few things coming up I'd love to share with you. I would love to invite you to Easter at Heartland. It's the greatest day of our faith, and it's a cause for celebration. We will have Easter services starting this Friday evening, April 7th, and they will continue through April 9th. Easter is also the perfect time to invite someone to church. Most of the time, your friends and family will say yes if you personally invite them. So share the invitations that are in your welcome guide today. There are also invites on our social media platforms. We're looking forward to an amazing Easter at Heartland with you. We believe God gave gifts and talents to each one of us to fulfill the unique purpose that He created us for. Here at Heartland, we love helping people discover their purpose, and we do this through our three-part Heartland Growth Track. The next Growth Track cycle begins on Sunday, April 16th, with Step 1. Pastor Darren will teach everything live, and you'll be given the opportunity to learn more about our church and become a member. Whether you've been coming to Heartland for years or are brand new, this spring is the perfect time for you to check out the Growth Track. It will take place at noon in our chapel, and childcare and lunch are provided. There's always a lot of great things happening here at Heartland. To stay up to date on all the latest events and details, be sure to follow us on Instagram and Facebook. I'm looking forward to all that God is going to do today, and I know you'll enjoy today's message. And I pray God's blessings over you, because today is going to be a great day.
Yes, it is. It's going to be a great day. Hi, everybody. Good to see you. Welcome back. My name is Darren. For those of you who don't know, welcome to Heartland. And I just welcome you, not in the name of any church, any religion. I welcome you in the name of the living God who created you and who loves you, and you're made in His image. And you're going to be inspired today through this whole morning, but glad you're here. Take a moment and grab this connection card out of the seat pocket in front of you, especially if you're here for the first time. We'd love to meet you and connect. I promise you, we're not going to market or sell this. This is just a very personal way where, if you're interested, we'd like to engage in a conversation with you. We can answer questions. If you'd like more information about our church, our mission, if you have a question, or if you have a prayer request, there's a spot at the bottom to fill out a prayer request. And we pray for those every Saturday. There's a great prayer service, by the way, that you don't know, every Saturday morning at 9, and we just pray for people. And hundreds of these little cards will be prayed for. So whatever's going on in your life, you can mark it confidential if you just want that for the pastors, or if you'd like everybody to pray, just go ahead and write it on there. Put that in the offering boxes on your way out. and you will be prayed for hundreds of times this week. How many of you know that God answers prayer? Do you know that? Do you know that every week God does miracles in people's lives, and it's because we pray? We can do nothing in ourselves, but God answers prayer. So we'd love to pray for you. In the news, you heard that the growth track has an adjusted schedule for the month of April. Normally, steps 1, 2, and 3 occur with the first Sunday, second Sunday, and third Sunday of the month. Well, because Easter is happening next Sunday, we're going to start the growth track the week after, just for this month only, on the 16th and the 23rd and the 30th. The growth track is our version of a membership class. So if you're thinking about being a part of this church, you'd like to learn more what we believe, how we handle money, what we do with everything, just come to that. And most of all, we'll help you discover what your spiritual gifts are and where you can make a difference for God's kingdom. Most people don't know that, and so they spend their whole lives looking for fulfillment, not knowing that God has a calling on your life. And once you connect with the thing that God gifted you for, your life will never be the same. You'll be filled with so much fullness of knowing that this is what I was made for. So we'd love to help you with that. Come to the Grow Track. I will be teaching that live, so that'll start on April the 16th. Well, it's time for the offering, everybody. Time for us to give to the Lord, and all the different ways to do that will be on the screen. But thank you for your generosity. I failed to mention it in the last service, but because of your generosity, we never have to do an appeal for fundraising when something like these tornadoes that just ripped through. We've already sent money on your behalf. We've already given to our partner Convoy of Hope, and help is on the way. And that's your ongoing giving allows us to do that. Thank you for your generosity. The dedication of the Way of the Cross was yesterday. I don't know how many of you came out to that. Wasn't that an amazing morning where we just got to see this beautiful process, the stations, the progression of Jesus on his way to the cross? Before you go today, if you want, just take a walk out around to the south side of the building, walk to the cross on the side of the building, cross the parking lot, and you'll see the first station. And you can walk and see this beautiful place that your generosity has provided with no need to borrow funds. We did it with cash. Thank you for your generosity. Now today, before we get into God's word, I've asked Pastor John to come sing an old hymn. And what I'm doing with this, you'll notice this has been a little change for us, is I really think we're all moving at a speed that makes it hard for us to hear God. So I want you over to this next song to think about what Jesus has done for you. Think about it. Has God ever done anything for you that you've not been able to do for yourself? That's every one of us. And so to get our hearts right, I want you to take a deep breath, and I want you to hear this word. And then also take out this little communion cup. I'm going to lead us through the remembering the Lord's sacrifice today, his body and his blood. We'll do that later in the service, right at the end of the message. But I want you to have that now. If you don't have one, you can ask one of our ushers and they'll bring it to you right now, okay? God, I thank you for the ability to give to you. Thank you that we don't just worship you empty with just our words or our songs, but we bring you the first part of our lives. God, I pray that you would take every gift that is given and you multiply it and you would use it in a beautiful way to touch people and help people come to know you, Jesus. And I pray, Lord, that you will touch people who are hurting. Thank you that you've provided already, but Lord, we pray that you will do more through us, Lord. We don't want to just receive, we want to give it out. So Lord, help us to be your hands and feet in this world. Now, Lord, we open up our hearts to you and we're ready to hear your word. Touch us and meet us today. God, I pray for the supernatural spirit of peace. Silence the voice of every accuser. I pray that the spirit of peace and the presence of God would fill this room now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble. Were you there they crucified my Lord. Were you there when he rose up from the tomb? Were you there when he rose up from the tomb? Oh, sometimes I feel like shouting, glory, glory, glory to the Lamb that was slain. Were you there when he rose? From the tomb, 'cause Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, but he
so good. If you don't mind, I'm just going to talk right from here today. I want to speak right to you like I'm sitting in your living room. Welcome all of you who are joining us online. We are in the ninth week of a series called The Jesus Way. It's the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. And actually, it's the conclusion of the first part, the first section of this sermon, where Jesus is giving us Beatitudes, attitudes of the kingdom of God, that he calls you and I to climb higher. Not everybody wants to be a doer of God's word or a follower of Jesus. They want to be part of the crowd, but he calls people who want to come with him to climb higher, to be in the world, but no longer of the world, to be in it, but not of it. And so he gives these beatitudes because here's the big idea. Who you are becoming is far more important to God than what you're doing. Religion will make you do things and will give you lists of things that you have to do to impress God. God says, I'm not impressed. You just heard the song. Jesus paid it all. He did everything for you, but he calls you to something higher, and he calls you to the attitudes of his kingdom, attitudes that will allow the Holy Spirit to come and fill you so that you can do the things that Jesus did. You can't do those by yourself. This sermon is impossible. In fact, it will frustrate you the farther we go into it if you try to do these things in the power of your flesh. But if you have the right attitudes, you will welcome the Spirit of God, and Christ will come and actually live his life through you. So these Beatitudes comes in sets of three, and I'm just going to read through the scripture where we have been so far. This is the quick review. Jesus, seeing the multitude, seeing the crowd, decides to climb higher, and he goes up a mountain, and when he is seated, his disciples came to him, and then he opened his mouth, and he taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who recognize their need for God. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Something's got to change. And your heart breaks over the things that break the heart of God. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Wait a second, I need to change. And God reveals himself to the humble. That's the first three. And then blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. People who say, all right, I'm ready. I'm going to go all in for God and his righteousness. But it's paired up with blessed are the merciful, for they're the ones who shall obtain mercy. Don't forget, in your pursuit of righteousness, don't forget that you needed mercy too. So the mercy you've received is the mercy that you also need to give. Because, listen, there's nothing greater than righteousness, but there's nothing more ugly than self-righteousness. So then he says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. It's the combination of this zeal and this pursuit of an all-in search for God and his righteousness, to do the right thing with the humility of knowing I need mercy, that actually makes you a humble, pure person. I have no pretenses, no hypocrisy. And then we come to this last three. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. And notice, the first time that we are identified as sons, daughters, children of God is when we commit to doing the work of Jesus, being a peacemaker. I've been teaching you about the difference between church people and children of God, not the same thing. And we're going to talk about that today. Because if you commit to actually thinking like Jesus, doing the things that he said, pursuing his ways, walking in his footsteps, don't be surprised if persecution comes. In fact, one author said, blessed are the persecuted. In other words, if you keep pursuing peacemaking, you better get used to the sight of your own blood. Because persecution will follow if you actually do the things of Jesus. Blessed are those, put it back up on the screen again for me. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. This was last week. Blessed are you when you're persecuted for doing the right things, because yours is the kingdom. And then here's today's. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil falsely for my sake. The first eight Beatitudes are in the third person. Blessed are those. But there's something about persecution that's so personal and feels so personal, and we make it personal and we take it personal when we're persecuted, that Jesus comes and just addresses us directly. Did you notice the change? Blessed are you when you feel persecuted. So let's talk about this today. Blessed are you when you are persecuted. But God says you're blessed when you're persecuted for doing the right things. Not persecuted because you were a jerk, not persecuted because you were obnoxious, not persecuted because you felt persecuted and all you were was just criticized. We are kind of an oversensitive people today. We're kind of take things very, very personal. You honk the horn at us one time at the light and we will give you daggers of death. I was just trying to help you move along, but you thought I was criticizing you and persecuting you. Or you thought I was just asking you to proofread your work. And you thought I was the worst persecution, like I called you the author of Sharknado or something. You know, like people take things so personally today. I feel insulted. I feel criticized. I'm quitting on TikTok today. Because we're just taking things so that's not persecution. That's not what he's talking about. Blessed are you when they persecute you for righteousness. This is persecution for doing the right things. Persecution for doing what is right. And then Jesus goes on and gives you this second. He makes it real personal. He says, blessed are you when they revile you. So what's revile? That means that they insult you. Check, happened. Blessed are you when they persecute you. That means when you're attacked for no reason. Check, that's happened. Blessed are you when they say things falsely against you. Check, happening right now. This is what happens when you do what is right. There's something about following in the way of Jesus, and I know nobody wants to hear this today, but persecution will come. I hate to break it to you, but if you try to do the right things and you try to change your behavior, let's say that you decide to go all in for Christ and you're a young person and you show up at your high school and you say, you know what, I'm not hanging out with that crowd anymore. I'm going to live my life differently. I'm going to live my life in a way that's honorable and pure and right. You're going to disrupt the status quo a little bit, and don't be surprised if there's some mocking and some persecution and people pull away from you and ghost you a little bit and stuff like that. Don't be surprised if that happens. Don't be surprised if you're at work and you decide, I'm going all in for God, and you know what, I'm not going to cheat on that report anymore, and I'm going to do the right thing, and I'm going to tell the truth, and I'm not going to hang with that crowd, and I'm not going to that club after work with y'all anymore. And I'm going to, don't be surprised if the world comes for you, because you're changing the way, and people will feel, what are you trying to judge me now? Are you, and you're just trying to live your life for Christ. Don't be surprised if you change your behavior to do what is right, that persecution will come. But what I'm also trying to tell you is, don't be surprised when you try to live for Christ. Don't be surprised if the persecution sometimes comes from church people with a cross on their neck and a Bible in their hand. Persecuted for doing what's right. I had a dad in this church tell me about his 20-something son. They were on the car together, son, girlfriend in the back seat, mom in the front, and they were going through a McDonald's line, and the son decided, the 20-something son decided to tell his dad, "I ain't coming to your church anymore, not coming to Heartland," because he was listening to a pastor from another church who said, "That church does not take a stand on the issues. They don't preach against homosexuality, Dad, so I'm not coming anymore." So the dad says, "You know what? You're right. I haven't heard Pastor Darren go off on that. But I also haven't heard him go off on fornication. And haven't you all been living together for like 3 years? You guys in the back seat?" And the guy and the son goes, "Easy, Dad. Whoa, easy, easy." And they went through the line, and the lady says, "Here's your cheeseburgers, here's your Cokes." And the dad says, "That's for the fornicators in the back seat." People are forever trying to get me to denounce their favorite pet sins. Come on, somebody. If I don't do what you want me to do, I'll... Look. Call me out. I know I'll take responsibility for what I believe. I know what I believe. I stand on the Word of God. I preach the Word of God. You criticize me for preaching the Word of God, fine. I will stand on that all day long. But if you never came to this church, you never heard me preach one time, you never came to the Grow Track, you have no idea what I'm going to talk about, you might not want to listen to that criticism coming from the street. You might not want to listen to that just came from somebody else. Like you never did any due diligence of your own. Come on, somebody. I had a member of this church tell me that they went to the pastor of their former church and they said, "We've been here for a long time, Pastor. We love you. We appreciate you. We feel called in this season of our life to join Heartland because we want to be a part of building bridges. God is doing something beautiful and we want to be a part of bringing people together. And we just feel called and we're asking for your blessing." First of all, what an amazing thing that somebody would even do. I've been ghosted like 200 times a year. And for just a person to come to their pastor and say, "You know, I just feel God moving me in this season." Every good pastor knows that people don't belong to us. I don't know how long I'll be somebody's pastor. Spiritual authority is actually a gift that people give to me. So I don't know how long they will allow me to speak into their life. It could be 6 weeks, 6 months, 6 years. I don't know. But for however long it is, it's just a privilege to be able to do it. And all good pastors know this. So they were going, you know, to their pastor and asking for his blessing, which I think would just be amazing. "Let me pray for you. Let me bless you. Go out and serve God's kingdom. Thank you. It's been awesome. I hope you always look back on the time with us with a smile on your face. It was one of the greatest times of your life." And listen, I get to pastor a lot of people now all over the world, at all kinds of places. And some of them still come to this church. I don't own anybody. So it would be a great thing when someone comes that. But this guy goes to their pastor, all black church, and says, "Please, pastor, bless us." The pastor smirks at him and says, "Huh, really? All right, go hear the white man then." True story. That's horrible. That's terrible. Persecuted for doing what is right. And I hear what people say. They don't say it to me, but it trickles back to me, you know, like they told you and then you told me. But I heard it. I heard it. It came back. "Pastor, we used to," you know, they don't say pastor. They say, "You know, we used to like Heartland, but it's getting a little too urban." That's what they said. Church people said that. You would think that if we're bringing people together in the vision of a book of the Church of Acts, where people came together, old, young, white, black, Jew, Gentile, however, wherever you came from, and we're building the kingdom of God on earth, you'd think that would be celebrated. You'd think people would like that. You would think that people would want walls of hatred and division to come down. You would think it. No. Some people don't want that. Some people are offended that we didn't cater to their particular preference every single Sunday. Do I have a little soapbox today I'm standing on? I get off of that. Sometimes you will be persecuted just for doing the right thing. Reviled, insulted, attacked for no reason, lied about for no reason. And my assignment to do today is to tell you that don't think it's strange when that happens to you. Jesus said that they insulted all of the prophets. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, watch this, when it happens, because your reward is in heaven. And so they persecuted Moses and Isaiah and Jeremiah and Zechariah and John the Baptist and all the prophets who are before you. The church people persecuted those guys in the same way. I know that's a shock, but they persecuted Jesus too. And Jesus said, no servant is greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they'll persecute you too. I don't know why we're so surprised when people say things about us, lie about us, hurt us, and we were just trying to do the right thing. Am I preaching to anybody today who ever felt misunderstood and you were just trying to do the right thing? So I want to talk to you about what this word means, rejoice. When he says, not if, notice the scripture says, when you're persecuted and you were just trying to do what was right. I want to bring some encouragement today because he says, rejoice and be exceedingly glad. And you say, Pastor, are you kidding me? How am I supposed to rejoice when they lied about me, when they attacked me, when they insulted me, when they said these things against me? You want me to rejoice? Well, let's clear up what this word rejoice actually means. First of all, the word rejoice, number one, does not mean that I like it. It doesn't mean I enjoy it. It doesn't mean it feels good. It doesn't mean that I like what's happening, that it's fair, that it's true, that it's not evil that's being said. It doesn't mean any of those things. In fact, you're not going to like it at all when persecution comes. And in fact, don't you know that Jesus identifies with you? Do you remember, we've just built this Stations of the Cross that is, it's a way of putting the scripture into physical form where any person can, when they're suffering, they can walk in the footsteps of Jesus and gain perspective about their own sufferings. And you can come and look at, if he suffered this, then maybe my suffering's not so bad. Do you know what the first station of the cross is? These scriptural stations that we put in place. The first one is Jesus saying, Father, I don't like it. Father, it doesn't feel good. Father, what they're doing is evil. Father, this is not something I want to do. Father, if it's your will, can you please take this cup away from me? And then he says, nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. You see, rejoicing has to do with a choice. Rejoice is a choice that you make. It's not just something that you feel. You're not going to feel this. The word rejoice, you got to re before the joys. before there's joy, there's something that you've got to choose to do. And don't be surprised when this criticism comes, who it is that's bringing the criticism. Again, think about Jesus. Think about, he was just trying to do the right thing. And why did they criticize Jesus? Think about this. Jesus was upending the religious system of the day. There was a culture. There was people who were in and people who were out. There were people who were good and people who were bad. There was us, and then there was the outsiders. And Jesus comes in and he loves the sinner. And he loves the Roman sympathizers. And he loves the people that are caught in sexual sin. And he blocks for them. And then he defends them. And then he forgives them. And then he says, you don't have to live in that sin anymore. Go and sin no more. He just engages them. And they're just totally offended. You can't love the Samaritan. You can't touch the leper. You certainly can't eat and sit down with a tax collector. The religious people had an order, and Jesus was upsetting the order. And I wonder if today, in the world that we live in, if there's not a difference between who the children of God are. Like, if you actually listen to what Jesus said and do what he tells you to do, you're going to be amazed. As we step out of the Beatitudes and step into what Jesus actually calls us to do, you're going to be shocked. Because he sets such a high standard. He sets a standard that's higher than anything that's in the world today. And he calls you to it, and it's going to upset the religious order, not just of his day, but I think it would upset the religious order of this day. Look who put him to death. It was the chief priests and the Sanhedrin. So the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and all the other religious scholars, they had this council called the Sanhedrin. And watch this. They began to plot and look for false evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death. He healed people. He fed people. He He touched people who were sick, raised people from the dead, reached out to people who were sinners. In fact, Jesus one time, he says, I didn't come for the righteous. I came for the sick. I came to be a hospital. I came to be a place where sick people could come. I had one time a person say to me, I ain't coming to your church because you don't have a statement on anti-racism. And I said, well, first of all, there'd be a problem with that because this would be the greatest place for a racist to come. I would actually welcome that. Actually, a racist should come to this church because I got a living statement going on every single Sunday. You want to come see it? How about you just come visit one Sunday? Come be here and come experience. I'm on everybody's toes today. If I don't hear the amens, it's like hearts changing. That's what I'm hoping will happen today. It was the chief priests and the Sanhedrin that put Jesus to death. They come up with their false charges and their false witnesses. They lie about him. They're slapping him. You read the story. They're spitting on him. They're punching him. And he's done nothing to deserve it. And he doesn't respond. They take him to the Roman governor and they say this. They say, we want you to crucify him. And Pilate does an examination. The world examines Jesus. And you know, look what the world says. The world says, but I find no fault in him. Which often people in the world have problems with church people. They don't have any problem with Jesus at all. And the Pilate, the world says, but I didn't find any fault with him. And they said, we have no king but Caesar, which was a total lie. What a hypocrisy that was. They don't love Caesar. They're not going to submit to Caesar. They just want their agenda done. They're using religion and they're using politics to get what they want. Oh. Y'all, see, I told you I would mess with your heart today. We have no king but Caesar. They led him away to be crucified, and bearing his own cross, he went to the place of the skull. Jesus was persecuted falsely, lied about, beaten, and it came from both sides. He was killed by the world, but the church had something to do with it. And when you get to the station, the 10th station of the cross, if you walk in the way, and by the way, if you walk the way of Jesus, you will find yourself in the story. You just look at all the people that Jesus encounters. Are you the betrayer? Are you the one that got anxious and you love Jesus and you're horrified at the betrayal, but now you're afraid and now you're, you know, cursing and cutting off ears? Are you anxiously responding? Are you afraid? Are you the woman who meet Jesus along the way, hearts breaking? Are you Simon the Cyrenian, a black man who is forced into involuntary servitude and forced to carry the cross? And yet doesn't realize, one day he realized, I carried the cross of Jesus. What an honor that was to carry Jesus' cross. Are you the Pharisees? Are you the Sadducees? Are you part of the world? Are you the criminals on the cross shouting insults and one realizing this is the, you will find yourself in this story. And Jesus, in the middle of his crucifixion, we get to that 10th station, they've nailed him to the cross, and he looks down from that position, and he looks at the people who are insulting him and reviling him and his accusers. Those Sadducees and Pharisees are there, the soldiers that put the nails in his hand, they're there. And he looks down and he says, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And they divided his garments and cast lots. With that is an important detail. That means they stripped his clothes off. He was naked on the cross. And from that position of, imagine being stripped naked, being persecuted and killed, and saying, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. I'm just saying, rejoicing does not feel good all the time. When you read rejoice in the scripture, it's a decision that you're supposed to make. It's not something that you feel pretty much all the time. You're not going to feel it. It doesn't feel good to endure persecution. And yet the scripture says, rejoice and be exceedingly glad when persecution comes. So here's my second point. That means rejoice is a choice that you make no matter what comes your way. Well, how am I supposed to do that? They persecuted me. They attacked me. They insulted me. They don't even believe what I believe. Rejoicing is a choice that you make. when people criticize you. I know what this is like. I have been there, friends. I've been a pastor for 22 years in this community. I've had good days and I've had hard days. I've had days where I praise God and days when I praise God anyhow, and I had to tell my soul, you will praise the Lord today, because you don't feel like it at all. When you're persecuted, when you lose, when people leave, when people ghost you, when people say things, and you are just trying to do the right thing. I remember in the year 2004, maybe, we had just come out of 9/11, just a few years, and there was a Muslim community in our community that purchased a church building. And you should have heard the buzz of the church people in this community. Like, those people bought a church, and what a travesty. And they just had a lot of terrible things to say, and I could hear the buzz. So I decided I'm gonna go over there. So I walked over and says, hey, I've been hearing a lot of the stuff. I told the imam, I met him. And I said, I'm sorry about what you've been hearing. I just want you to know there's a difference between church people and children of God. I actually showed him the scripture, and he knew it, what Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. I just want you to know that not everybody's gonna treat you this way. And I just want you to know that I'm your friend. And he says, well, you know, we all believe in the same God. And I says, no, we don't. our faith systems are totally incompatible. But now that that's out of there, I just want you to know I want to be your friend. I care about you. And I think that we have a lot of shared values, the way we raise our children. And there's lots that we do have in common. And couldn't we work together somehow? You know, I bet there are some things that you wish that people knew about the Muslim community. And I definitely want your community to know that there's a difference between church people and children of God. Why don't you come over on a Sunday? I'm going to do a message about this. And they agreed. And the imam came, and that Sunday came, and they brought the imam, and about 20 of his community came, and I introduced them to our church, had people stand and clap, and then I preached this message about here's what Muslims wish everybody knew, and here's what we as Christians wish that everybody knew about who Jesus is. And I preached the gospel, everybody. I just went right through, here's what it means to be a child of God, Romans and everything. And when it was all done, I just said, this is the heart of God. He loves you. You're created in his image, and he wants to know you. At the end of that service, the imam comes. He has tears in his eyes, and he hugs me, and he says, you are a true Christ follower. One of the greatest compliments I ever got in my life. We had some food, and we hung out, and it was great. But then I saw one of my members looking at me with red from the neck up. He was so upset. He was angry. He waited until everybody left, and then he cornered me, and he said, I'm so upset that you would endorse this false religion and give honor to this false teacher and blah, 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 blah. And he goes, I demand an apology to this church and all that. And I said, whoa, whoa, whoa. Did you not know what Jesus said? You shall love your neighbor as yourself. And first of all, the fact that 20 people from the Muslim community came to church today and heard the gospel, you ought to be celebrating and thanking God. This is a great thing. It's a great day. And we just shared the love of Jesus. So don't you know the scriptures that say, show hospitality to the foreigner. Treat the stranger among you as if they are one of your own. It's in the Bible. Look at the outline. Look, there's Romans 3:23. It's all there. And he goes, this was not what I signed up for. And have you know, I'm the largest contributor to this church, young man. if you don't apologize, I'm out of here. You'll never coming back, never giving anything again. And I said, look, I'm so grateful for all you've done for our church. Thank you. But you need to understand, this is who we are. We are the children of God, and we're going to behave the way Jesus called us to behave. And this is where we're going. I'd hate to see you leave the church over it. And that was it. He left in a huff, and we never saw him again. So Monday morning, I went back to the Muslim community, and I said, hey, if you ever feel persecuted and misunderstood, and you watch people treat you the wrong way, I know how it feels. And I choose you. We're going to be good friends for a long time. The amazing thing about that story is a beautiful friendship came out of that. And last year, when they dedicated their brand new, you've probably seen it in town, that big big masjid that they built. And they had the lieutenant governor and congressmen and senators and our mayor and all these people from the state showed up. And then they had the guest speaker to come deliver kind of the dedication speech. You know who they asked? Yeah. What a privilege to be able to go. And I opened up with the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verse 4. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. And I shared this story, shared God's word on the opening day of the Muslim community's opening of their building. I'm in there talking about Jesus. Because we have a friendship and we have a real relationship. And it's because, but I can tell you that, some of y'all don't even know what to do with that story. That's a little, wait, Pastor, I was tracking with you till you said Muslim, and then, whoa. You don't know what to do with it, because I'm telling you, there is a cultural version of what following Jesus looks like, and then there's what Jesus actually says. And Jesus doesn't give the Pharisees a choice. They're like either you know, he's claiming to be a king and forgiving people, and so either we follow him or we kill him. So they killed him. And so this is the choice. What are you going to do when you start following the way of Jesus and you start saying, I want to be a son or a daughter of the Most High God, and then the people come for you? What are you going to do? Well, the scripture says, rejoice, be exceedingly glad, but I don't feel it. Well, that's okay, because number two, rejoice means to choose joy no matter what. Well, how do I do that? Well, look what we fix our eyes on Jesus. Look at what he did. Fix your eyes on Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. Wait, you missed it. How did he endure the cross? For the joy that was set before him. He saw something outside of the circumstances he was experiencing, something that hadn't happened yet, but he had his eyes fixed on that. See, he could have had his eyes fixed on the whipping. And he could have had his eyes fixed on the nails that were in his hand. And he could have been focused and fixated on the spear and the crown of thorns and the mockers and the fact that he was naked. He could have been fixated on that. He could have been fixated on the insults. He could have been fixated on the mockers and the lies that were told. And that's not what the scripture says. He had his eyes fixed on something else, the joy that was set before him. Do you know what the joy that was set before him was? I'm so glad you asked. The joy that was set before him was you and me. And he saw a table. He saw a table in heaven where one day, because of his sacrifice, like, I can endure it now. It's a terrible Friday, but Sunday's coming. There's a resurrection coming. Like, I'm going to rise out of this. I'm coming out of this. I'm not going to stay in this. And there's going to be a table, and people are coming from every part of the world, from all time, every color, every tribe, every nation, and we're going to sit together in the kingdom of heaven. People who were lost and without God now have a chance to sit at the table. And so he saw you and your sin, and he saw me and my sin, and he saw all of the people. He saw that, God, you want to save your people. You want to redeem people. This is the message of Easter I'm going to share next week, by the way. You ought to think about who you could bring, because they always ask me, well, what are you going to talk about on Easter? Same thing I talk about every year. Jesus died, and he rose again, and his resurrection means your resurrection. He saves, he heals, he restores, and he redeems. Same message, everybody, because that's what he does. That's the good news. That's the, you bring somebody who's far from God, and they're going to believe in Jesus Sunday, because you're going to be part of that. That's what Jesus saw your friends, your loved ones, people who were far from God, who next Sunday are going to give their lives to Christ, because Jesus paid it all. He endured the cross. And so for the joy set before him, he says, I can make it. And see, you can do it too. If you fix your eyes on Jesus, you're going to make it too. When you go through the persecutions and the struggles and you feel like nobody's had to have it as hard as me, well, walk the way of the cross. Read the pillars. Read what Jesus endured. Look what the scripture says. Don't be surprised at the fiery trials that are coming upon you, as if something strange were happening to you. It's not weird. He said it was going to happen. But rejoice in as much as you get to, and whatever it is that you're suffering, and you're not dying or bleeding to death. But you're suffering. But in as much as you suffer, you get to participate in the sufferings of Jesus. So you too can be overjoyed. You can find joy. You can choose joy. You can rejoice in glory that is to come. There's a better day coming. Joy is coming. I don't have to just endure it today. I can look at Jesus and I can choose joy. So what's my first point? What's my first point, everybody? You're not always going to feel it. You're not always going to like it. Number two, what can you do? You can choose joy anyway. And what's the third thing here? Rejoice means to stop seeing people as your enemies. The way of the world today wants to find an enemy for everything. And that's the way of the church world today. The church has enemies. And that's not the way of Jesus. To rejoice means to see that people are not my enemies. Let me remind you that our struggle is not against flesh and blood. It is not against people. It's not against, the devil is manipulating people like pawns to try to get at you. He's hurt people, and he's trying to hurt people. He comes to steal and kill and destroy to get people to hurt you, but they're just the pawn. He uses people to destroy your infrastructure, like the Russians bombing Ukrainian electrical infrastructure right now in the dead of winter has one purpose, to discourage and to demoralize. And that's what the enemy's trying to get to you through the persecutions he sends your way. He just wants to discourage you, demoralize. We should just give up. That's the whole plan of that war, by the way, and it's demonic because that is the role that Satan always uses. He wants to discourage you. Even when you're doing right, you should just give up. You're not fighting against people. You're fighting against spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. But Jesus knew this. This is what's amazing. Study Jesus. Fix your eyes on Jesus. How did he do it? The man who supervised the nails going into his hands. Jesus never says a word. He doesn't open his mouth. He doesn't shout. He literally says, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And the centurion looks up at the end of his crucifixion, at his death, and says, truly, this was the Son of God. And there is something about how people see you when you're persecuted that identifies whose you are. The way you respond under persecution says something about who your Father is. And there's something about when you endure it and you rejoice and you keep your perspective and you keep your eyes fixed on Jesus, the world will look at you and say, truly, you are. Blessed are you when you're, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God, especially when you're persecuted, like especially when they see how when you're treated wrongly, the world will say, that's not church people. That's a child of God. And so I'm about to share with you the way of Jesus. I have been criticized many times for, oh, you don't preach the truth, you don't say it. Look, let me just tell you how it is. This is as deep as it gets. The way of Jesus is so deep and so convicting and so direct. And again, I don't bring this on you to be heavy on you today, but I'm just telling you, the way of Jesus, you can't do it unless you have the right attitude and the Holy Spirit lives in you. So let it be said that we preach the Word of God at this church. We believe the Scripture, all of it. We believe in Jesus, who he is, and what he said. And this is as deep as it gets. Jesus said, love your enemies. Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who spitefully use you. When they strike you on one cheek, give them the other side as well. When they come for your coat and they sue you, or give them your shirt too. That is the total opposite of the way America works. I say again, there's a difference between the children of God and church people. And Jesus calls you, and I call you today. Are you going to climb higher? Are you going to stay and participate in the way of the world, or do you want to climb higher? Do you want to be known as the child of God? There's something about what will happen. If you decide to be a person that follows Jesus, the Holy Spirit will come and help you to be that person, and you'll be different than everybody. But expect that when you do that, you're going to be disruptive. You're not going to be like everybody else. Love your enemies, he says. Watch this. It goes on to say, love your enemies and lend to them. Like, be generous. Like, they try to take from you, fine. give to them hoping for nothing in return, for your reward will be great, and here it is, and you will be known, watch this, as the children of God. You'll be the sons and the daughters. See, what shows that you're a child of God is what happens to you when you're persecuted. How are you going to respond? For watch this, he is kind to the unthankful and the evil. Thank God he was kind to me while I was still a sinner. Jesus Christ died for us. When you didn't even know God, when you weren't searching for him, God had mercy on you. God saw you when you were far from God, and he says, I love you. I'm going to reach my hand out to you. He did not treat you as an enemy. God has no enemies. He reaches people wherever they are, and he calls them to himself. And the only enemy we have is a spiritual enemy that his fate is already sealed. But people are not your enemy. Be kind. God is kind to the unthankful, the evil. Therefore, be merciful just as your Father is also merciful. Woo! This is tough today. It's okay. Y'all don't have to say amen today. I just feel hearts shifting all over the room. I feel the hearts moving. So, to rejoice, let's just be clear. I'm not saying you have to feel, it doesn't feel good all the time. You're not going to like it all the time. It just means you have to make a choice to rejoice. And one of the choices you'll be making is that, well, people aren't really my enemy. See, if there's hate in your heart, ask yourself the question today. Does hate come from God? No. One of the ways I know that I'm saved, one of the ways that I know I'm a follower of Jesus, is that God gives me the capacity to love people that I know don't like me. I know they don't like me. I know they're saying things about me, and I'm going to love them anyway. You want something from me? Here, have it. I'll give it to you. I'll serve you. I'll bless you. I'll show you who my Father is. That's one of the ways I know that the Spirit of God is living on the inside of me. So how I see people, you can't hold on to the hate or the judgment in your heart and then expect that the Spirit of God says, why don't you get rid of that hate, forgive it, and let the Spirit of God fill you and give you the capacity to do something you cannot do for yourself, which is to love your enemy. And then here's the last one. The rejoice means then to let God work his peace through me, even when it costs me. See, you can't do this by yourself, but if you have the right attitude, see, these Beatitudes open up the kingdom of heaven. There is a higher order. You don't belong to this world. You might have been born an American, but you have a higher calling. You belong to the kingdom of heaven. Your heart is gonna beat to a higher order, to a different rhythm. You're going to be able to see yourself as in the world, but I don't have to be of the world. I can live my life as a child of God, as a servant of Jesus. I don't have to live just by the order of the world around me. I can transcend it. The Holy Spirit can give me the ability to do that. So God can bring his peace into my life, and then I can give his peace to others, listen, even when it costs me. Jesus finishes this little section on the Beatitudes, and he goes right into a little section which usually is never preached together. They always split this off, and I don't think I've ever heard a sermon where they tied this next verse in with the Beatitudes. I mean, have you guys ever heard? They never tie be salt and light in with being with the persecutors. And the reason why, I don't know why they don't do it, but if we just let the scripture unfold before us, the very next thing Jesus says, you are the salt of the earth. You're the light of the world. But how will the salt ever change anything if it loses its saltiness? Like if it's just salt, but it doesn't really act like salt. Like it no longer has any flavor. It has no preserving capacity. It has no ability to change the flavor of anything. Or what good is light if you just have it all covered up with bad attitude? A lot of times that just gets preached as make sure you share the gospel with people, be salt and light. No. This is all about people are watching how you behave under persecution. So when you're persecuted, this is your chance to show up as salt and light. You know what salt does? Salt permanently alters everything it touches in very subtle ways. And what light does is light pushes back darkness. Light exposes. You don't have to do much. I don't have to show up with a tract in my hand. I can just show you how I behave when I'm persecuted. And people say, something's different about that person. That might be a child of God right there. Let your light so shine, watch this, that they may see your good works and they'll glorify your Father in heaven. Jesus later prays that on the night before he goes to the cross. He says, Lord, I pray that they will be one so that the world will know that you love them and that the world might believe that there's a God in heaven. And this is what our lives can be. That's why we have this opportunity. I don't know what you're suffering today, what hard thing you're going through, but listen, it's a choice to rejoice. You don't have to focus on the hurt. Focus on where God is taking you. You may be going through a hard time, but it's just temporary. God's going to bring you out. God can give you life and give you joy in spite of what you're going through. And when people see the way you respond, you get to be part of what God is doing in the world. Here's the last verse again. Rejoice. Be exceedingly glad. Luke's gospel would say, leap for joy. Actually, I don't feel it. How can I leap for joy? Self, praise God anyway. Praise God anyhow. God, I thank you that you're going to bring me out. Sometimes you just have to preach to yourself. God, I thank you that I'm not going to stay here. God, I thank you that there's a great reward. God, I thank you for the table in heaven. And that's why I want to bring you today. Pull out that little cup and that piece of bread, because we're going to walk through, take out that piece of bread. And as you pull it out, let me just show you what this ninth attitude is. This is what Jesus did on the cross. He chose joy no matter what. I rejoice. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross. And so today you hold a symbol of Jesus in your hand. And it's your choice today. God, I will choose to rejoice no matter what. And the promise is that the kingdom of heaven is yours. Like if you just surrender to Christ's way, everything that God has will be yours. So the journey started off with, God, I recognize my need for you. And it ends with, God will give you everything. Even his Holy Spirit, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, can come live inside of you. So let's walk through the Beatitudes. We hold this piece of bread in our hand. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who say, God, I recognize my need for you. Something had to change. I needed to change. I'm totally lost without you. I'm a sinner. Jesus died on the cross to pay for every one of your sins, past, present, and future. And the humble who believe this, they'll receive the forgiveness of Christ. Maybe just pray this prayer and then we'll eat this together. Father, I need you. Change my life and forgive me. Let's eat this together. The next set of three. Father, I'm going all in. I want you and your righteousness. Thank you for the blood of Jesus that cleanses me from all of my sin. Move me out of the middle. Get me out of apathy. I give you my whole life. Lord, thank you for the mercy that I've received. Thank you for the Holy Spirit that enables me to endure. Thank you for a pure heart. Thank you for a pure heart. Let's drink this together. The cup symbolizes the blood of Jesus, his life. So this is the last three. God, I thank you for your life in me. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for coming into my life. Give me the power to walk like you, to be the peacemaker you are. Lord, give me the power to endure under persecution. Give me the ability to act like you act and to reflect you, to be salt and to be light and to choose joy. Let's just do that today. God, I choose joy. I choose to rejoice. God, bless your people with joy. Give them vision. Help them to see that there's something greater. Help them to look ahead. God, I pray you'd fill your people with faith. Fill them with your Spirit today. God, I pray that as we go all in for you, I pray that we will not be the same. Continue to heal us, restore us, redeem us, and may we not recognize ourselves. Even as a church, a year from now, so fill us and change us, the whole world will know that we are the children of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Come on, give God a great hand of praise, everybody. Amen. You guys all right? You guys good? Hey, got a good lunch coming. You guys are going to be fine. You came to church today. You let God do some surgery on your soul. And if you prayed that prayer for the first time, I'd love to help you grow spiritually. So if you will take that connection card out of the seat in front of you, check a box that said, I've decided today to go all in. I'm giving my life to Christ. Check that little box. I'll communicate with you. Actually, take it to the front desk and they will give you a book called Begin, How to Begin a Real Relationship with Christ. That book is for free if you just take that card there. Or maybe you just want prayer, or maybe you'd like to be baptized. Whatever you need, just communicate it on that card and we'll connect with you. And then our prayer team is going to be here as people are leaving. If you would like to come and receive prayer for any reason, our team will be here. My wife and I will be out in the lobby. We'd love to connect with you and just say hello if we've not met yet. For all of you online, just write the word begin and then email, send it to info@heartlandchurch.com. We'll send you that same book absolutely for free. So glad you joined us today. I'm so glad you came. You guys good? You ready? Father, bless your people. Send them out with joy. Give them perspective. Help them to be your children today, to be salt and light. And we look forward to celebrating your death and your resurrection next weekend. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys. I love you. Keep coming back.
Shame. Yeah. We're billions of hearts, lights in the dark.